Dental plan.
Leeson eats braces.
Dental plan.
Leeson eats braces.
Dental plan.
Leeson eats braces.
Dental plan.
Seventh episode of the Toonzone podcast. My name is Ben Applegate, coming to you from beautiful, snowy Seoul, South Korea. With us today, we have our producer, Karl Olson, in Kirkwood, Washington.
What up?
Matthew Williams, our graphics editor in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Yo.
And Jay Allman, our former editor-in-chief in Norman, Oklahoma.
Well, we'll see if you have me.
Yes, we will. All right, the big news, obviously, recently is that Disney has announced the purchase of Pixar in a $7.4 billion deal that will make Steve Jobs the biggest shareholder of the Walt Disney Company. As part of the conditions of the deal, John Lasseter, Dr. Ed Catmull, the president of Pixar, and Bob Iger of Disney cannot die before it is completed, or the deal will fall through. So that just really puts into sharp focus how important the creativity of these people is for the deal to happen. Jay, I know you wrote an op-ed piece about this. You probably basically the theme of your op-ed piece was "Told you so."
Basically, you know, it's not that often that I get to say "I told you so." So, you know, I have to strut whenever I have the chance.
Oh, you got to take those chances, absolutely. What was your take on this whole deal?
Well, my take on it is that this is something that almost had to happen because Disney just absolutely needed Pixar. And even though a lot of people didn't really realize it, I think Pixar really needed Disney. Disney needed Pixar because Pixar is the biggest and best producer of contemporary computer animation that's out there. If Disney didn't pick up Pixar, one of its competitors would, and at a stroke, Disney would lose its biggest and best supplier while seeing a really big rival established to it. So it had to buy Pixar. I think Pixar had to go with Disney because Disney's the best possible distributor of its work.
I think it's, everyone else kind of sucks. to put it nicely, they at least kind of suck.
Right. I do think the really big news for Disney, the reason why this is such a great deal for Disney, is because it gives them an alliance with Steven Jobs, who is one of the few people out there who seems to have a real vision for where digital distribution is going to be going. And that's going to be the next big frontier in Hollywood, is figuring out ways of selling movies and content over the internet. And by bringing Steve Jobs in this rather intimate way, by giving a seat on the board and giving them a major share in Disney itself, they'll be able to cement an alliance, I think, with Steven Jobs, and that'll really give them a leg up on the competition to get stuff out there into the digital distribution pipelines.
Right, quite a few shows owned by Disney or networks owned by Disney are already out on the iTunes store from ABC and Disney Channel and other places.
Jetix is,
and you think this will just improve that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean it's a good combination on the whole. I mean, it gives Pixar security and like control of a studio that's going to give them it gives them access to like any creative talent that's been neglected by Disney over the past few years and managed to survive the layoff. They're going to be able to get their hands on and, you know, really develop. So that helps a lot.
And it raises the wonderful prospect that the studio behind The Wild could be euthanized.
Yeah, and we've already seen, you know, Toy Story 3, that's dead now, and, you know, thank God, because I don't think that would have worked. I mean, I don't even think they were going to be able to get the VAs back because they're like, we don't want to go back without Pixar. We're not stupid.
Well, the director was the director of Lion King 1.5, right? Of the Toy Story 3 project, and so he had experience at least making lemonade out of lemons, as it were.
True.
So I actually don't think that movie might have been as bad as everyone thought it would be, but still, it's obviously better to have Pixar making sequels to their own movies.
Exactly.
I think right now, like, a lot of the optimism is coming from Jobs, Lasseter, Catmull and even Iger saying exactly the right things. And this is stuff that a lot of fans have been harping on for years.
Right.
Like, people are saying, oh, Toy Story 3, you shouldn't be making that. And they're like, okay, we'll shut it down. People have been complaining for years and years and years about the cheat pulls, and Jim Hill Media actually has a quote that Lasseter, Jobs, and Catmull don't want them to do that.
The interesting thing about this whole thing is it's all come in the aftermath of the ultimate defeat of Michael Eisner.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this really is kind of rubbing the salt into the wounds of his ouster.
Yeah.
Well, it couldn't have happened to a nicer guy.
Amen
to that.
Interestingly enough, one of the things that wasn't widely reported is that Lasseter not only is the chief creative guy in animation, he's the chief creative guy in Imagineering, which is the theme park part.
Actually, I think that could work really well because a lot of the physics and that kind of stuff that you deal with in 3D can translate over to robotics.
And does this mean that we can look forward to a Nausicaa ride, perhaps?
Oh, that would be sick.
Okay, maybe a Spirited Away ride would be come sooner, but still. Yeah. I think that'd be really cool.
But, yeah.
Cat bus. Instead of a monorail.
Yeah, what's interesting, too, is, I mean, not only does this reflect good on Lasseter and Jobs, it reflects really good on Iger as well,
yeah.
Because he's giving them free rein.
Mm-hmm.
He's giving, like, one of the most remarkable things, this relates to the WDI part, not the animation part, but when Iger asked him to be creative advisor for WDI, Lasseter, apparently, according to Jim Hill, Lasseter said, listen, I know you've been cutting the budget for WDI for years. If you really want me to do it, up the budget. And he said yes.
Well, that'll get him in good with his new underlings then.
Yeah, that too. That'll help. The other thing is that this probably solidifies where Ghibli's films will be going to in future because Lasseter and Miyazaki are, you know, really tight. I mean, they're really good friends, and I can't see him wanting to shop those projects around when it's like, well, if I just sell it to Disney, I know Lasseter's in charge of the overall creative thing, so it's not going to be screwed with.
Disney has done really, really well by Miyazaki. I mean,
well, yeah, but partially
he has no reason to go anywhere else. Really.
Well, yeah, but partially because Lasseter was involved with the process, and now Lasseter is even more involved with the process.
How much chance was there that Ghibli was going to go to anybody else?
I don't think there was necessarily
a lot. I think the only consideration was is that if Disney was on bad terms with Pixar, there's no and Pixar had gone with another studio, they might have wanted to go to whatever studio Pixar was at because he knew that John would be willing to go to bat for him.
The Oscar nominations were announced last week, and in the feature category, the nominees were Corpse Bride, Wallace and Gromit, Curse of the Were-Rabbit, and Howl's Moving Castle. Pretty much nothing else could have been nominated. I mean, those were obviously the three to nominate, and pretty much it's clear that Wallace and Gromit is the one to win.
Yeah. I would be really surprised if anything else picked it up. And the thing is I wouldn't necessarily put Corpse Bride in the number two spot. I think
that's the thing about Oscars, right? The number two spot doesn't really matter.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's interesting that it's so... I don't think I've seen anyone say anything other than Wallace and Gromit taking it. I don't think in anything that I've read in newspapers and trades and all that, it's just... It's a Wallace and Gromit win, which is fine because... Nick Park certainly deserves it.
And in the short feature category, we have Sharon Colman's Badger, John Canemaker and Peggy Stern's The Moon and the Sun in Imagine Conversation, Anthony Lucas's The Mysterious Geographic Explorations of Jasper Morello, Shane Acker's Nine, and Andrew Jimenez and Mark Andrews' One Man Band, and that's a Pixar short. An interesting selection. Badgered, I've seen. It's just a short, funny film. I don't think it really has a chance of winning, considering what else is in the category. I haven't seen The Moon and the Sun, but I've heard it's a very interesting family drama type film. Nine was supposedly made with equipment from UCLA just by this one guy. And that's pretty incredible, but I haven't seen that. One-man band is the Pixar short, as I mentioned. And Jasmine Morello is a very long for a short feature, but it's a science fiction fantasy type classic suspense tale set in a world of floating airships and floating cities. And it's just one of the most incredibly creative pieces of science fiction animation that I've seen in a long, long time. It's just a wonderful, wonderful film, and I can't say enough good things about it. But it's the first time I've seen a piece of science fiction animation come out of Western hands in recent memory that I've just been blown away by it, and everything in it has worked, and it hasn't seemed pathetic at all. You guys should all see that when it comes out on DVD in the States. I saw it at the Seoul Cartoon Festival and reviewed it for Toonzone, so...
I do recall that.
In connected piece of news, the Golden Globes has started up a feature animation award. The Hollywood Foreign Press Association voted on it last month, and it's going to go into effect starting next year with the awards in January. Finally getting with the times, so to speak.
Yeah, well, it's put this way. Usually it's kind of like the Golden Globes kind of beat the Oscars out to these kind of ideas, so the fact that they were beaten out by the Oscars to this is... I think they're probably taking... Especially the other thing is that this next year is going to have a ton of animated features come out, enough that they'll probably have 4, maybe 5 films in consideration for the Academy Award next year. So I think the Golden Globes really had to sort of step up and take notice on this. They couldn't be like, well, it's just cartoons, we don't care.
Well, on the Oscar, I know it's 3 or 5. It can't be.
Well, okay. Well, I think it's going to be... Well, it's probably going to be 5 next year, because isn't there something like 20 or 30 films coming out?
Yeah,
it's just a ridiculous number.
You guys have probably all heard about this, but Genndy Tartakovsky is lined up to direct a new sequel to The Dark Crystal, the classic Jim Henson film, with his studio Orphan Animation doing the computer-generated backgrounds. The puppet elements will now only be the foreground characters. And it's set several hundred years after the end of the first film, and a new protagonist is looking for a shard of the Dark Crystal to... I think it's to keep the sun from dying or something like that. Mm-hmm.
They have the hardest time keeping that crystal together, don't they?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, when I first saw that movie, I thought it was actually really amazing but incredibly dull.
Yeah, that's exactly what I would have said about it.
Well, I'm glad someone out there agrees with me, because I felt really bad pissing all over this beloved film from people's childhoods. But,
I know I was a kid and I wasn't that impressed with it.
But I know that Tartakovsky has a really good action sense and a good sense of pacing, and so he'll probably move it along a little bit better. And the Henson Company has had a bit more experience with more action-oriented puppeteering since then. So.
Well, yeah, and they've gotten a lot more experimental in some ways as well. I mean, I saw Mirror Mask, which is Jim Henson, and seeing what they were willing to do in the way of 3D experiments, and I think that Tartakovsky and the Henson as it is now is a very good combination. That should result in, you know, it may not be what people expect for Dark Crystal, but it will be an interesting and engaging film nonetheless.
Right, if it gets made.
I mean, Tartakovsky's had such hard luck with this stuff.
Yeah, you know? We've been burned before on him coming out and saying, "I'm doing this." No, wait.
Well, it's I mean, Astro Boy was, you know, it was like that kind of hinged on the TV series working, and Sony shot themselves in the foot on that one. I mean, he's written, I think, a couple drafts on it, and I guess it's still sort of in the air. They're still hamming around on it, but he's like, I want to do some work. So if, you know, Jim Henson's going to get their crap together, more power to him.
Well, I feel like if he has a successful film, then maybe that'll get Astro Boy off the ground.
Yeah, that could help.
But what I'm afraid of for Dark Crystal is that it'll turn out to be cult popular and be looked at as a failure by the mainstream.
Yeah, it doesn't need to be like huge. It doesn't need to be like $100 million film, but he needs to have something that's going to be like at least 20-30 million, probably more like 50. I think the other thing is that it will help if it works, or even if it's a cult film, it's definitely going to help grow orphanage animation. And I think it's interesting, kind of as Pixar is now sort of being subsumed by Disney, I think orphanage under Tartakovsky has the potential to be the next Pixar, that, you know, he'll be their Lasseter and guide them towards a, you know, successful career of animation. But it needs, in a sense, he needs to catch an even break first.
Okay, we've got some questions from readers this week.
Wow.
I know.
Oh, wow.
Soraya C. writes, first off, I just want to say the podcast is genius. I really enjoy listening to the interviews, the reviews, and all the stuff in between. I have to admit, sometimes I don't have a clue what you're talking about, like mind games, huh? Hey, I'm still trying to keep up with it all. I'm just an 18-year-old who dreams to become a professional animator.
Aww.
Well, I'm just a 22-year-old who knows he will never be a professional animator. So.
Ditto.
And I'm just a 22-year-old who has no idea what he wants to be when he grows up, even though he is grows up.
I'm 36, and I still don't know what I want to be when I grow up. I think we see a pattern with the guys who are running Toonzone.
Oh, dear God.
Yeah, there you go. Anyway, here's my question. Even though the Boondocks is gradually getting better, do you think the animation has hurt the show, humor-wise? I mean, if Family Guy looked like anime, would it have been as funny as it is? Hit me back on that.
I think the bigger thing isn't that the animation style, it's just the quality of animation at points has been really uneven. They've had episodes that are really nicely storyboarded and really nicely animated, and then they've had other ones that are just absolutely clunky. And it can be kind of excused because they're a new show and you've got this sort of new studio being put together, but on the other hand, some of these guys are like 10, 15-year veterans and should know better. And especially with a million-plus-dollar budget, so...
I think he kind of has a point, though, from a stylistic standpoint, because most American shows are very quick to warp the characters around, and the faces on the characters are a lot more expressive in a certain sense than if you go with an anime style show. Well,
particularly because they're not necessarily, it's anime style, but they're not necessarily picking up on the comedic cues from anime. So they don't have, since you can't, they're limiting themselves from both directions in some ways.
Well, he's a big fan of Samurai Champloo and hyper-realistic action shows.
Right. Well, the thing is even Samurai Champloo will have episodes that are really, in some ways, exaggerated. The baseball episode is, of course, over the top, which I don't think that's run yet. So,
but not in the same way. Yeah. Not in the same way as Homer dancing through the land of chocolate. You know what I mean?
Oh, God. We come from the land of chocolate.
All right. We also received a rant. Self-admitted rant from Robert Willing. Can you do a discussion about the recent cancellations of various Nicktoons that are very good, but Nickelodeon is dropping for whatever reasons? Some due to their own mishandling, but lack of accepting responsibility, like My Life as a Teenage Robot, Jimmy Neutron, All Grown Up, Chalk Zone, etc. And yet in their places, putting in total garbage like Cat Scratch, The X's, and they've dumbed down good shows like Fairly Odd Parents and SpongeBob SquarePants.
Well, to be fair, I think Fairly Odd Parents and SpongeBob are the result of them losing staff over the years, and without the exact same staff there, you begin to sort of lose the right timing and balance that made it work. I mean, SpongeBob, a lot of their staff has moved on to work with Camp Lazlo has a lot of SpongeBob's old staff on it. FOP has been spread out over a bunch of the people that were originally sort of all pretty much concentrated on that are now working on different Nicktoons projects and different Frederator projects, which has sort of spread them out. I mean, shoot, even the creator himself, I mean, even Butch Hartman himself was sort of running two things at once by doing FOP and Danny Phantom. Teenage Robot has just been something that Nick has dragged their feet on. I mean, it's a good show, and I think, and it's been consistent about its quality. It hasn't gotten bad if anything, it has improved since the earlier seasons. It's just been, it's so designed in some ways. It's got such, graphically designed animation that I think it might be a little intense for some viewers, I think, at points. It's really hard to describe, but it's a really great-looking show. I'm just not sure whether it's something that kids are going to glomp onto because, it's at 22 where you're like, they've got these 50, sort of nouveau, modernist kind of things going on in the design and these lines and that kind of stuff. Yeah, it's really neat. From a kid perspective, it's like, but they don't have, battling and monster trading. Well, I mean, they have battling, but, it doesn't have the, it doesn't have, the simple kind of kid appeal necessarily at points, so.
To give you an idea of what a very young kid is thinking, my young 3-year-old nephew is addicted to Jetix.
And Jetix is pretty much just, explosions. It's not complex television.
Not that we demand complex television all the time.
No, not by any means. Otherwise, I wouldn't have purchased Bottle Fairy.
Oh, God. Wow. I don't even know what to say to that.
Now I know more about Japanese culture, though, Ben.
Really?
Vaguely.
That's the worst excuse ever.
Oh, man. Okay. But, I mean, I think it's interesting because even with some of these cancellations, I don't think they're always bad things. I think Danny Phantom, I'd rather see that end early than have it be sort of drug out way past the point of being interesting, because they apparently have lost one of the key staff members on that, and they wouldn't be able to do another season without that. And if they did another season without that guy, it would be feel like a different show. And Fairly Odd Parents has had this repeatedly. They've lost, you know, writers and staff and stuff, and I think it points to the only person who's stuck with the show is Butch Hartman. So, I mean, in a sense, it's better to end this kind of stuff early than, like, drag it out to, like, 150 episodes, and it's just painful to watch. You want it to die. I'd rather you be like, no, don't cancel it, than, like, thank you, God, for canceling. I'd rather see that be the situation for shows, that they're ending early rather than way after they had been relevant and interesting.
Yeah, like a show that starts with the letter S and ends with Simpsons.
Yeah. Yes. That could probably, you know, at least six Amen. Seasons too long.
So send your questions to tzpodcast@gmail.com in text or MP3 format. We'll be sure to get to them on the air. Aftermath of Viacom's destruction in a violent fireball, CBS has decided to merge its UPN network with the WB and create a 50-50 collaboration network called tentatively the CW.
Dear God, I hope they change that name.
Oh, yes.
For the love of God.
Supposedly, Kids WB is not going to be affected by that. And UPN, of course, doesn't have a afternoon cartoon block, so...
Do they have a Saturday morning cartoon block? Boy, this still...
I don't think they even have one of those anymore.
Until 1999, they had a national block, which I think was programmed by Saban, believe it or not.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I remember
and
that.
And then in 99, they lost that, but they signed, like, a network-wide deal to get Disney's 1-2.
Hmm. But I never saw that run, like, regularly. Anyways, this is going to be interesting because it's going to open up a lot of stations are suddenly going to be syndication again, which is kind of perfect considering BKN's considering of they're trying to relaunch their syndicated stuff in the States again. So that'll, you know, suddenly they have the networks to do that. It's going to be interesting to see what, you know, kind of cartoons you're going to get out of CBS and Warner together.
Well, from what I heard, the animation block is going to be basically Kids WB.
Hmm.
Right.
I mean, which is a good, which is mostly a good thing.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Well, especially considering isn't for CBS's morning cartoon morning block, since they aren't going to be getting Nick's stuff anymore. They're getting stuff out of Deke.
Deke.
Which, you know, Deke. Yeah. We really want to see Inspector Gadget and the Gadgetinis. Oh, wait. No. Hell no.
Probably the most intriguing plot thread is, what is Fox going to do?
Right.
Fox owned, like, a lot of the big UPN stations because they bought out, like, the former half owner of UPN. And their stations in New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, are not getting CW. And which is probably a big middle finger to the face of Rupert Murdoch, because
right.
they signed a huge deal with Tribune in most of their markets.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see that because if you notice on the websites that almost the day after the CW was announced, Fox dropped any mention of UPN, any promotion. They modified all the UPN station's logo to get the UPN logo out of there. They just obliterated all mention of UPN from the network.
It's going to be interesting to see how Fox plays it. I think it's going to allow for some interesting angles inside of Time Warner, because they certainly seem to be making moves to repurpose some of their own cable networks, and this could give them the leeway to say, well, since we're changing some names around here, we're going to use that as the basis to change some names around here, and I've talked about this on the forums like a billion times, but basically Cartoon Network becomes like CW Youth Network or something, and then Boomerang becomes Cartoon Network. Whether that's a guaranteed, I don't know, but I could see them, if they're really so transfixed, as some people have said, on becoming Nickelodeon, this is the golden opportunity to do it. And CBS wouldn't mind it either, because they'd rather, it gives them something, you know, if this whole Deke thing doesn't pan out, well then, if they're aligned with what amounts to the new Nickelodeon, they were already running Nickelodeon content on their type content previously, you know, it scratches a lot of backs at the same time.
Stage, the fantastic webtoon made by former Toonzone, I guess he's former Toonzone poster, Matt Wilson, has come to an end in one of the most amazingly fantastic Back to the Future type endings ever. If you don't know what I'm talking about, check it out, bonusstages.com. I think it's awesome.
You know, it hurts that the series is ending, because I think it's better than probably 99% of what's on TV. That said, it's probably the best ending they could have done it.
All right.
I mean, whatever Matt decides to do next, I know I'm going to like. So, I mean, I'm not that worried about it, but...
Well, I mean, the other thing is it's definitely, I think the bigger thing is it doesn't suck that it's ending, and it sounds like there's still maybe a wrap-up episode or two to go, which I can see where that
would
make sense.
Or the fact that it's a huge hoax and he's going to actually continue it through 100.
If that were the case, that would be one of the most... I mean, in a sense, no matter how he plays it, he still managed to sort of do what William Street has always dreamed of doing, like a scale that they would have just loved, because they're such big fans of, like, the Andy Kaufman-style humor, and made full use of the medium that he has access to and ran with it, so much so that, like, his fans have played along with it, so you've got, like, Bonus Stage fan art up, like, the fan art site on DeviantArt only has, like, two blank pieces now. They're just black screens. The Bonus Stage wiki changed their, which Matt Wilson rightfully hates, because it's nuts to have a Wikipedia type thing for a Netune that's like can't even support the person who's running it. You know, they cannot fiscally support them. I think if you want to do something for them, you know, pay his bills, then make a wiki. But anyways, they went and played along with it, and they changed it so that their database is simply referencing only two episodes and all that stuff. So, I mean, it's interesting that it's complete. You know, it's just such an over-the-top way of dealing with things. I think the bigger thing about it, though, for me, is it kind of sucks that, like, the circumstances in which it came about. If it had happened at 100, as I think it was probably originally planned in some ways, I think it would have been fine. But the fact that he's having to sort of call the quits early because of real-life issues kind of sucks. Because, you know, it's kind of like, not only sucks because, you know, I like Matt Wilson as a person. He's a good guy. He makes good stuff. But it's kind of a sign that, you know, as much as the internet will hopefully one day be this great method and medium for distributing animation and content in general, we're still at a point where the only people who are really turning a buck on it are the people who got there first, and that for new people to come in, it's really tough. And that, like, the slightest thing that happens in real life and suddenly it can't be done anymore. You've got to focus on reality, because you can't spend 40 or 60 hours a week drawing a cartoon or making, you know, whatever. And it's a bit of a downer, because it's not just bad because a show's ending. It's bad because it's a reflection of problems that are, you know, have to be overcome.
We're here with some of the production crew from Zixx, the hybrid animated live-action show that premiered on Cartoon Network recently. Could you just run through what exactly you do on the show?
Which one of us?
sure, just give us your name and your title, I guess.
Alex, you start. I'm Alex Raffe, and I'm the show's, I developed the show, and I'm one of the executive producers.
I'm Tara Twigg. I was one of the co-producers for this season of Zixx Level 2.
And I'm Michael Shepard. I'm executive producer on Level 2.
And Level 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7.
We're planning.
Fantastic. Well, I haven't actually seen the show because I've been away from Cartoon Network for a while, but from what I've heard from Chad, it's good fun, and I'm certainly a huge fan of Mainframe. So really, I just wanted to know, first off, how you guys managed to get them to do the animation for the second season, and how the, I think William was interested in this too, but how the coordination between the studios has worked out.
Well, I'll take that. I mean, Mainframe were, we got a lot, we did the first season of the show in Toronto, and we used an animation company here, and in fact, they built a game engine, and we generated the animation using a game engine, which had many pluses and many minuses. When we moved the show to Vancouver, when Mike Shepard and his company got involved, Mike had a relationship or developed a relationship with Mainframe, and they were very keen to come on board, as I recall, Mike.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
In terms of the coordination, it's quite a trick because we write the scripts and go through the live action production phase while the animation studio is still, you know, in the preliminary design phase of their work. And what we're able to do is take the live action to rough cut, and then the animation has sort of more and more information being pumped into it from the live action side. And they work on the animation, and they've worked very closely with the Thunderbird crew in Vancouver and myself in Toronto. And we go backwards and forwards and spend a lot of time in the animation house, and there's a point at which we get the animation chunks for the episodes, and then we have to sit down and try and cut them into the live action, which, of course, inevitably doesn't go quite as scripted. So there's always some interesting and creative moments in the edit room as we actually stick the two elements together. And then we basically, after that, go back into the voice record and we'll rewrite chunks of script in the animated sections to make things funnier or explain things or make things work better. So it's a fairly fluid, interactive, back-and-forward process.
Now, using a game engine for the first season is kind of appropriate to the storyline. I mean,
we thought it was a brilliant idea, and we especially thought it was a brilliant idea because we kept being told nobody's ever done this before in television, and now after having done it, I now know why nobody's ever done this before.
Could you just explain a bit of the... I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, there were wonderful things about it. There was a sort of a look and... I mean, it was terrific once you got elements sorted out. The look and the feel and the cycle movements were great. They really felt like a game. The problem was the physicality of trying to manipulate the characters to do more acting than in those days or this style of game really is capable of.
Right.
You couldn't have characters touch each other, and we ended up by doing a lot of custom animation to cover script points that just couldn't be generated by the regularity of the game engine. We also ended up with some sort of, you know, we ended up by having to do the work in effect to build a game and debug a game, even though we didn't need a game. We only needed bits of it.
Right.
So it was a lot sort of three corners around the block. We had a terrific team, and they did an extraordinary job. But I think we probably did. I mean, they couldn't have made a penny on it because we ended up by doing so much more custom animation than we'd ever expected to. I think that the lead character at one point had 148 movement cycles. I mean, it was just obscene for game work.
A bit mind-boggling.
But it looked great because once you'd done all the work, we were able to have these incredibly busy environments where all this going on in the background without it all having to be animated painfully by hand or individually. So, I mean, you know, there were pluses and minuses.
No, I could be totally wrong, but it's a variant of the LithTech engine that you were using. Is that right? Or
what, sorry?
It was a variant of the LithTech engine that you were using? Was that right?
It was LithTech, yeah, that's exactly right, yeah.
Okay.
Exactly right.
And that was used in No One Lives Forever 2. Is that...
I think so. I know it was used in the Bond games.
Right. I was a huge fan of No One Lives Forever, those games. And yeah, so you're inheriting a worthy engine, at least.
I think the budget level's different, though, isn't it, from those games, perhaps?
that
could have been where we ran into problems right about there.
Could you explain really quickly what some of the basic plot ideas of the show is for the listeners that haven't seen it, maybe?
Yeah. Right now, only one episode is aired in America, so even if they miss that, they're still kind of behind on what's going on.
Well, the basic plot is it's the basic battle between good and evil. Our heroine is a character called Zixx Funky Z, who is an alien that looks somewhat like a late teens teenager. And she is a member of an intergalactic good guys force called the Network. She unfortunately has crash-landed on Earth and is without resources or ability to get hold of them. She just has her reptilian sidekick, who's a guy called Slango, and her partner, and cut off from everybody else. They are fighting the regeneration of the all-time world's worst bad guy, Onkelon, and his henchman, the Gox. And most of the battle takes place in a third dimension, or in a space that's an abandoned alien space, which behaves along the lines of games, uses all the principles of games. So what Zixx ends up by doing is co-opting a team of young humans to help her on her quest. And while she might be really good at beating the crap out of the bad guys, she doesn't know nothing from nothing about games. So these kids end up by contributing an enormous amount because they figure out the rules and how to find out where the prizes are and help her navigate to stop the big bad guys from taking over the universe as we know it.
And so in Zixx Level 1, which is just starting to air now, she has different human allies than she does when she gets into Zixx Level 2, which I guess we don't want to give anything away.
I was going to say, you just told the world that they win in Level 1.
I did?
No, not necessarily.
Don't know that.
There's a series of forward and backwards. They win things, they lose things, they learn from their mistakes, things are not what they seem, and they have to battle through and beat the keep, which is the name of this environment, is full of the most horrendous and deadly adversaries. And as one of the kids in the first season says, you know, I'm really good at the games where I can restart them when I die. And this, of course, is not an option.
It seems like you've taken some a lot of elements from Tron and The Last Starfighter and some of those wonderful 80s films that used computer environments and computer games as plot devices. Did you guys look at any of those in coming up with the plots for these shows?
We didn't look at them specifically, but they obviously have a big influence on where we were. I mean, we were very aware of the fact going into this that you couldn't... We were developing this around about the time that Lord of the Rings came out and the first Harry Potter and things like that. And it's like, well, the sophistication of the audience just went through a quantum leap, and even though you're working with television budgets, it can't go cheesy. So by making it that kind of convention, we felt that people would know exactly where they were in that space without us having to do it at sort of the latest Hollywood levels. I mean, games are now infinitely more sophisticated in many ways, but nobody has any trouble recognizing exactly where they are when they go into our game space.
Right.
Even though it's an older iteration. It's very Tron-like.
And we tried to keep a good, you know, the humor level always somewhere present so that, you know, it works for a good range, a good sort of audience demo, you know, from the younger kids all the way up to my older guys who are a lot, definitely grown up.
You guys kind of mentioned it, how the cast changes. I've been curious, did that come out purely due to story reasons, or were there outside factors why the cast changed?
So what changes?
The cast changed. That was a funny thing. It was primarily motivated by the fact that we moved from Toronto to Vancouver. And, you know, it's a huge pain to be shifting a whole bunch of young kids from one end of the country to the other.
But the biggest reason is our kids grew up.
It's puberty.
The biggest reason is our kids grew up. The older boy who looks so definitely sort of 12-ish, which is what he was, we in fact had him back on the second season. He comes back, he's got a guest spot.
Right.
He's like a basketball player, he's so tall, and his voice is broken. We had him do ADR, and it was just like, okay, nobody's going to know this is the same guy. The funny thing about it was we sort of, oh gosh, we have to do this. But once we got into it with the showrunner, who's a guy called Ian Weir, who was tremendous, the creative potential in it was great. it was really fun to change the team.
It was. And to make sure that the audience knew that our other team was still around.
Yeah, alive and well, and just couldn't get through the levels.
Mm-hmm. And you know, and they do. I mean, there are some story, little bits of story where we're going to see one of them again anyway. So we do, there's a continuum, which is nice.
I remember Ian Ware's name from Reboot. He's a...
Yeah.
He's a mainframe
guy. He wrote,
right?
You know, in the early mainframe days, he wrote several Reboot. He's also, for quite a few years, ran Edgemont, the series that aired both, obviously, in Canada for many years on CBC, but aired in the U.S. And he's just come off of a big big adult miniseries here in Canada. So he's one of the top guys here. But he's great at writing stories that work on so many levels. You know, like a 4-year-old can watch this, a 14-year-old, 24-year-old, or older. And, you know, they all get the jokes and the stories on whatever level. So that's one of his gifts, I think.
He's a serious heavy metal fan, which makes for a lot of running jokes in the second season.
Yes.
So perhaps that was Megabyte guitar riff was his fault, maybe.
Something like that.
Earl is our headbanger.
I loved Earl, and I wanted to see more of him in level 2.
Yeah, Earl might have to come back.
Yeah, I think he might. He was so good.
He's a great actor, Michael Eklund. I mean, he just nailed it. He's such a pro.
Yeah.
Well, it was one of those instances where the part was fun, and we liked it, and we all thought it was great on the script level, but Michael was the perfect person for the role. But he just took it and added some ingredient to it that we just never envisaged and made it just completely steal the show.
Mm-hmm. When we did the casting call for that role, you know, headbangers, you know, heavy metal fan, we had so many Hell's Angels guys come out, and we looked at the casting. It's like, oh my God, that guy scares me. He's going to scare the kids. So Michael came in, and he had this actually beautiful hair, sort of like Bono hair, like long flowing hair. We said, we're going to give you a mullet. He said, all right. But he was clearly just such a fantastic talent versus the other guys who really were headbangers.
Was it a bit more of a challenge to have voice actors talking to characters that don't have moving mouths? Because from Nux, that is a little strange to watch. But how was it to direct to the voice actors? Was it more difficult to act to that? Or?
No. The trick was always who got to do the ADR first, who got to do the voicing first. Because once there's one voice in there, it helped all the other actors find their place and find their level. The one that we usually made go first where we could, where time permitted, was Barbara, who plays Zixx. Because, of course, as a veteran of season one, she was fine with it. The neat thing about that was that the characters in the live action had done their stuff and shot their stuff, and it's 5 months later they're coming back in to do the voice for the animated sections, none of which they'd seen. So they're standing there in the sound booth and they're going, oh wow, this is so cool, this is so fun. They loved it.
And they're playing themselves.
They get a huge amount of energy kicking out. They knew their characters backwards, and they get a huge kick out of the animation, which was such fun for them. So it was really very easy to sort of convert that into the performances.
Well, you mentioned earlier about bringing characters back later and such. So I was wondering, what did the prospects for season 3 look like? Level 3.
They look, I would say, pretty good. What do you think, Mr. Shepard?
Yeah, I think it looks really good for season 3 and season 4. And we're really happy, actually, with our cast right now. I mean, those three actors actually are very popular. They're all getting a lot of work.
Yeah.
And Zixx is available. So we're, you know, they're all available, conceivably, although very busy, and they all look good and they're all very interested. I think creatively we'll certainly want to add new characters. You know, that'll be really interesting in 3 and 4. But I'd love to have a little more continuity. I think Megan is so much fun. I just love all of our crew right now.
Our Canadian broadcaster said it was really kind of a sort of an odd way of doing things. Most people do their best to build up real brand value and put some real sort of longevity in their cast, and we were the only show she'd ever come across where the most recognizable thing about the show we dumped at the end of the first season and had a whole new batch. But it's possibly not the way to go. And the continuity, I mean, the working with Mainframe, for example, was probably as painful a process for Mainframe as it was for us, as we're going backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards. You know, I'm sitting there going, no, I don't think it's supposed to happen like this, it's supposed to happen like this, and they're going, but it looked like this in the script. And, you know, it's very, very, we also wanted them and embraced them being interpretive with the animation. So it's like, you know, the writer wrote it like this, but we wrote a live action script, really, some of which happens to take place in animation, and it's up to you to come back to us and say, this isn't working, why don't we do it like this? Or, you know, that's a cliche, we could do a much better idea for an environment would be this. And I think they found that very exciting, but it took a long time before we all shook into the same groove. So as Mike says about the actors, the more of the crew that we can work with, Mainframe obviously again, the more of the crew we can work with, and particularly the cast, the better. And season 3 will be just that much more seamless.
Yeah, and creatively it makes sense. I mean, we'll go into a level 3. It's just, you know, if one of the kids goes through puberty and grows to 2.5 feet, then that'll be something we'll have to deal with. They did that in the Brady Bunch when Peter went through puberty. Was it Peter? If Peter went through puberty, his voice was changing, remember?
Yeah, Jamie.
So, yeah. It's an occupational hazard, I guess.
I mean, sometimes it can work. We'll actually have to see, because that had already started happening even in the ADR. So we'll just have to see. But we did. They're all so fantastic, these particular actors, that, you know, we'd be honored to actually just go again with all of them.
She's fantastic. It's just at that age, there's so much changes in one year, because it'll be less than a year, hopefully, when we go into level 3.
Mm-hmm. So my brother's 14 years old, so I'm right there with you. I can completely understand that. Yeah, I came home from school and he's, you know.
They just morph. They morph. Oh,
it's incredible. It's incredible. To hear the story behind getting the show on Cartoon Network and how that all happened.
It's complicated. you know, I gotta say that the support we got from certain online websites was really, really helpful, because there seemed to be a bit of help there. But you know, the Cartoon Network, their executives are really savvy. They knew about it. You know, look at your website, and they'd actually done. They knew all about it even before we did, to a large extent.
Wow.
But you know, the principals over at Mainframe and certainly David Ozer over at IDT, they all have very good relationships, and it's. You know, everyone knows everyone, and Cartoon Network had been following it for a little bit of time. And I think when they decided to put a live action show on Cartoon Network, Zixx being the first one that they're doing, I believe there's another one they're launching at the same time. Just reading on that today,
right.
But because we have the CGI, and I mean half of the show is it happens in the keep in the CGI, you know, animated world, that makes it a hybrid, which I think is a really good fit for them.
There are some on our on the internet out there who would say, you know, you're destroying the soul of Cartoon Network with your terrible live action show.
Oh, come on!
I don't feel like that once they've seen it.
I saw some of that stuff. People, but you know, everyone's got a feeling about everything. So,
on the internet, absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
I certainly hope they will take the time to watch the show anyway, because it sounds like a lot of fun, and I'm a huge fan of the kind of thing that you guys seem to be trying to emulate with the comedy along with the adventure aspect.
Well, it was one of the things that felt had to be done because you can't seriously put 12-year-olds in jeopardy unless it's fake jeopardy. And we wanted to have them really be responsible for the consequences of their actions. So the only way to make that then not horrendously scary is to make it funny.
In regards to that type of thing, do you run into any standards and practices issues in producing Zixx?
We didn't have any. We didn't have any. The broadcasting reality in Canada where we made it was basically that, I mean, we have avoided sort of obvious gun things and all kinds of stuff like that, but obviously in the environment in the keep where they have weapons and inventory and all the rest of it, it's inherently about a degree of violence. But we avoid gore and sort of bloody decapitations and things like that, so we keep it on a slightly more sanitized kinds of violence. And what we're able to do in the keep is not reflective of what we're able to do in the live action. The live action has to obey still the